Start in few minutes. We can go live.
Okay, we are live now.
Good morning and greetings to one and all. Technex is proud and honored as today we have among us His Lordship Justice Deepak Mishra Sir, who was the 45th Chief Justice of India from 28th August 2017 to 2nd October 2018. Sir has been part of some landmark judgments, notably leading the bench which declined Yakub Menon's appeal to stop his execution and upholding the death sentence given to Nirbhaya rape convicts, and presided over the striking down of Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code. Now, I would like to call upon our Associate Dean of Student Affairs, Professor Rajesh Kumar, to formally introduce our Honorable Speaker.
Good morning, students. Today, we have gathered here to celebrate Technex 21 virtually for the first time. I am delighted to take this opportunity on the last day of Technex 21 to speak a few words about BHU and its 100-year legacy. We are also pleased to have Mr. Deepak Mishra with us for this session. We welcome you, sir, wholeheartedly at this Technex. Banaras Hindu University was established by Bharat Ratna Mahamana Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya in 1916 with a mission that students should have education, good education, along with the character building. And he also established the engineering institution in 1919 as a Banaras Engineering College named as BENCO, and he was also an honorary member in Industrial Commission, Indian Industrial Commission 1916 to 18, where he convinced the rulers of that time that the engineering education is very much required, particularly the degree. And then you can see that what was his vision that mining, metallurgy and chemistry all are in the same place, because the subject is important in the interdisciplinary nature of the subject he has considered at that time, and it is in one place, name as MET. And then he also established a techno, another college, and where we see the chemical engineering department, ceramic engineering department, and pharmaceuticals. So this was his vision. And finally, it came in particularly in the present time, the IIT, which is established in 29 June 2012. Now, I would like to introduce our speaker, Justice Deepak Mishra, who served as 45th Chief Justice of India for 13 months from 20th August 2017 till 2nd October 2018. He enrolled as an advocate and practiced in constitutional, civil, criminal, revenue service, and sales tax matters in Odisha High Court and Service Tribunal. He was later transferred to the Madhya Pradesh High Court. He became a permanent judge in the year 1997. Justice Mishra assumed charge of Chief Justice Office, Patna High Court in 2009, and charge of Chief Justice Office of Delhi High Court in 2010. Later, he served as Judge of Supreme Court of India in 2011. He was appointed as Chief Justice of India on 28th August 2017 and remained as such till he retired in October 2018. He devoted his life to justice, judging innumerable profile cases, steering our country in the direction of justice. Thank you, sir, for joining us today. Now I invite Mr. Deepak Mishra to share his thoughts and motivate our students so that in this the era of information, they have a crowd of information, but how they should have clarity in his mind so that they can decide in and make a good future. Please, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Morning, sir.
I would like to address you as friends. I must tell you, it's a great delight to talk to you. It has been just told that they would invite the speaker. I do not intend to give you a speech. I am here to talk to the young minds of a different field, not the field of law. I'll try my level best to talk to you in a different kind of language, which possibly be connected with your thinking process, possibly from the crowd of thoughts, as has been referred, you'll be able to choose some and appreciate. Having said that, I must also tell you that my joy, my delight, my happiness would have been extremely accentuated had I been physically with you people. But the nature being unkind, we are facing this pandemic, and that is why we are meeting in this virtual world. You see, I always felt when you go amongst the young, you understand what is the concept of energy, what is real energy, what is the strength of intellectual curiosity, and what is the spine of a big country. That is why I always love to go with the youth. Some people ignore young mind. They're not mature. I totally disagree with them. I am of the considered opinion, youth has its own spark, energy, prowess, and ability to invent. If you go through the history, you will find Gautam Buddha. He was enlightened at the age of 26. Mahavir Jain got the prowess of learning almost at the same age. Adi Shankaracharya, who traveled throughout the country and propagated the ideas of philosophy, especially how to understand the universe and the humanity in it, within span of few years, and he lived up to 32 years. John Keats, one of the greatest poets of English language, died at the age of 26. Look at his poems. He says, truth is beauty and beauty is truth. This particular line has impressed scholars from around the world, and they are still thinking what this particular line can mean. Similarly, P.B. Shelley died at the age of 29. Look at his creativity. Byron died at the age of 36. Alexander died at the age of 33. So if you really consider these factors, by no stretch of imagination you can say that youth doesn't have the genius. I am of the sanguine view, youth can create, youth should never be ignored. On the contrary, youth should be encouraged. And in fact, if you have the potential humility, you must learn from them. Now, I feel today I am talking to the nation's potential innovators. An innovator, as I feel, has to be mentally agile, conceive of ideas without any kind of compromise. He must harbor an inclusive philosophy, and that apart, he must constantly feed, to quote a phrase from Barack Obama, the former president of United States of America, "Yes, we can." I'm saying in, because he has said in plural, so I'm quoting him. "Yes, we can." It's a small sentence of three words. "Yes, we can." But look at the inner energy within. It is the filament, like a bulb, in a bulb. And if people know what a filament is, and how that can really sparkle. The litmus test of a creative mind is his ability to believe in himself. And that is why I would also like to add, you must be absolutely confident, or to put it in a different way, you must assure yourself every moment that I will do it. Once there is a certainty of thought, you can create, you can innovate. And that was the thinking process of many of the American scientists and scientists of the various parts of the world. What is the difference between a person who doubts and a constant doubter? I would suggest all of you must have a sense of doubt. Unless you doubt, you cannot develop the idea of curiosity to pose questions, to move forward, to walk on the path of progression. This is an affirmative doubt. But if you become a constant doubter, you will be achieve nothing. Your life will be spent in doubting everything. And that is called doubt of a cynical person. A cynical personality is deprived of creativity. He cannot invent. He cannot proceed on the path of innovative thinking. Therefore, my suggestion to you, never be cynical, never be skeptical, never be a constant doubter. Doubt you must to understand things so that you can create. Having stated about the doubter and the doubt, and the constant part of it. I always believe, and I would request you to adhere to such faith, because it's a tested one. He who lives in newness and constant nowness, he has the potential energy as well as the kinetic energy to proceed on the path of creation. I repeat this sentence: newness and nowness you must have. A person who doesn't believe in these two concepts, he remains in the state in the past. Past is necessary to understand. Do not be critical of the past all the time, but simultaneously never get pegged down by the past. Recognize the past, understand the past, read the past, but remain in newness and constant nowness. According to me, any innovator, any inventor is a kind of leader. It might surprise you that how can he be a leader? He works in a different atmosphere. There may not be many people, but his invention, his creation has a leading perspective. Now, when I say leader, I would like to add, there are three categories of leaders. One, I am not talking about the leader, and you must appreciate in the common parlance, but in the parlance of intellect, in the parlance of creativity. The first category of leader is one who will announce to you, look here, I'm a great intellectual, I'm a great innovator, I'm a great creator, follow me, you will succeed. He is a self-assumed propagating leader. I will put him in the third category. I'll give him 35 marks, just pass mark. The second category of leader, he will only say, I have read these books, I have done this. He will not tell you to follow him. He has different abilities, efficiencies, capacities. He will attract you. He is in the second category. Let us give him 50 marks. Then comes the principal category of leader, the first one. He will not say that he is an intellectual. He will not tell you what he has read. He will never announce what he has invented or innovated. He will never tell you, culture your ideas. He will just speak to you. He will never ask you, follow me. And that person undoubtedly deserves 80 marks. I'm giving the marks in the conservative method. I do not know what is the modern method of marking. People are getting 90, 99%, I know it. But I'm conservative in that way, that's why I've given this mark. Having said that, I will tell you something relatable to a sense of creativity and the mental factor. All of us know that we have our mind, brain. Brain is different than mind. But we will concentrate on brain. Or let's go to mind, because I will explain the mind better than brain, because brain is a physical thing. Mind is something different, and the neurologists have not been able to find where the mind is. But anyway, there is a theory. Every cell has a mind, and every part of our thinking is controlled by neurons. Some other way, which I can't explain, that's complex. But anyway, come back to the various facets of the mind. First, intelligent mind, or call it intelligent brain. Intelligence. Second, intellectual brain. Third, emotional brain. Fourth, instinctual brain. Fifth, unifier brain. Now, let us understand. All of you know, and it's a common knowledge, most of the time, our physical actions, mental actions are coordinated, and that works at the instinctual level. And when you are applying your common sense, your mild knowledge, you are in the intelligent mind. That's functional. But when you are talking about intellectual mind, that's on a higher plane. Emotional brain or emotional mind is at the lowest, because when you are emotional, you are not in actuality or reality applying your thinking process. You are ruled by your emotions, your sentiments in a different way. An intellectual sublimates his emotions and sentiments. You look at all the scientists and philosophers, starting from Einstein, Bertrand Russell, George Bernard Shaw. They have been able to sublimate their emotions. They have given their reactions as human beings, but that's different. You have to accept there has been sublimation of thought. And the greatest brain power, my dear friends, is the instinctual brain. I'll give an example. Supposing X is throwing a cricket ball towards you. You are standing at a distance of 15 feet or 20 feet. What do you do? What's your reaction when you come to see that he is throwing the cricket ball at you? You will immediately run from the path of the cricket ball, go 4 feet away or 2 feet away to save you. Which brain is helping you? Which mind is assisting you? It is the instinctual brain. Just imagine, if you apply the intellectual brain, you will try to compute and calculate the velocity, the size, the distance, And by that time, the ball will hit you and you will be carried to the hospital. That is why it is said instinctual brain works much faster than other brains. My purpose of saying is that as you are in the field of innovation, creativity and invention, take help of intellectual brain as well as instinctual brain. You may ask a question to me, sir, how do I have the control over instinctual brain? How can I order the instinctual brain to work for me? I can work understanding my intellectual mind, intellectual brain, intellectual understanding. But remember, on certain occasions, the instinctual brain comes to your aid. And you must be able to catch that. You must be in a position to understand and not ignore it. You have to filter. Every instinctual thought may not be correct, but take care of them. Look after them. Foster them. Nurture them. Look after them as if you are the mother. Thoughts are your children. And thoughts coming from the instinctual brain are better children in a different way. So after you assimilate, you filter. That is how you can really progress on the path of creativity. I was talking about leadership. The categories of leaders I have said, but one thing I would like to add, a sense of determination. I'll give an example from history. Abraham Lincoln was a lawyer. He and his partner were walking on the streets one day. They found a slave owner was beating a slave on the streets. That was legally permissible in United States of America before abolition of slavery. Lincoln at that time was no one, just a lawyer. He told his friend, look, one day if I become something, I'll teach these people a lesson. I'll see that this goes. And when he became the president of USA, he tried his level best, convinced everyone, brought an amendment, and got the slavery abolished. True, there was a civil war between the Southern America and Northern America, but ultimately, slavery was abolished. Freedom to them was given. How? Because the man was determined and he felt even he had to sacrifice his life, he will achieve it. That kind of commitment, dedication, and determination is expected from an innovator. Now, having said that, let's come to our philosophy or shlokas. You see, I consider Gita of Mahabharata as narrated by Lord Krishna is a pure practical philosophy. It does not speak of any religion. There is no religion there. He says, do your duty. Kanmanne vadikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. You have the authority over your work. You can't control your fruit. You don't have control. This is in contradistinction to someone saying, Bhagyang phalati sarvatra nacha vidya nacha paurasam. This is not correct. Unless you work, how can you get the results? Fruit comes because of hard work. Here I will give you the example of Adi Shankaracharya. Somebody asked him, sir, how do you distinguish between karma and fate? Karma is your purusartha, what you can do, your strength, your ability that has been endowed. Shankaracharya said, he gave an example. There is a big lawn. Lush green grass. And in the middle, a cow is tied. It has been given 50 yards of rope. So it goes on grazing every day. So the cow stopped at 40, feeling that there is no green grass beyond this. So eventually whatever it could get, and when the grass grew, you only moved there. Sustain, I use the word, only could sustain, did not go forward. Shankaracharya says, it could have gone to 50, isn't it? It could have gone to 50, because rope was for 50 years. That is within his limits. But could it have gone to 51 or 52? No, because rope was not there. That is fate. We do not know how long is the rope. Therefore, the duty is to do karma, to go on working. Because we do not know how far our ability, our work can carry on. Whether it is 50 years or beyond 50, we do not know. That is why it has been said, Charaivati, Charaivati, Charaivati. Work, go on working. And that is the innovator's job. The other day, in a meeting, I said, due to modern inventions, artificial intelligence has come into the human world. It is being used at certain quarters in the legal world. Some people have started using it. I'm able to talk to you not because of artificial intelligence, because of the digital connectivity. which could not have been possible few decades back. That's science. And artificial intelligence has to be encouraged. There are many people who are scared that artificial intelligence can eventually command human intelligence. I'm a strong believer artificial intelligence shall always remain subordinate to human intelligence. I hope the modern minds of today, the young minds of today will agree with me. Or put it this way, make a commitment that we will make artificial intelligence subordinate to us, because we are the progeny of the human race. We cannot be surrender to any intellect, any other intellect. We create agencies, they cannot overpower. Having said about science, I also like to tell you, sometimes a confusion comes in the mind whether the world or the human life is governed and controlled by science in entirety or there is something else. Had I been talking to you directly at BHU, I would have asked you the question from someone to understand the answer. That privilege I don't have today. I have posed the question, I have to answer. Believe this, science is a path of rationality, but it does not control life in entirety. It is because today's scientists, neurosurgeons, neurophysicians, psychoanalysts, psychologists, they have written books that there is something beyond science. So accept science and simultaneously, without being superstitious, accept something else which I am not able to define. But you can read books of neurosurgeons who conduct 10 surgeries in your human brain. You must understand the world from a bigger spectrum. Like I pose a question towards the end. Do not totally be engrossed with the Darwin's theory of evolution. That's not the end of knowledge of science. That's not the end of knowledge of philosophy. There is a book called The Proof of Heaven. You can note down The Proof of Heaven. It is written by an American neurologist. His name is Eben. He is talking about the spiritual world, the world of spirits. I ask myself a question. If there is a world of spirits, how do we accept Darwin as the ultimate, there is a doubt. And this intellectual doubt must also concern you, bother you, and you must think better than Darwin. Darwin's theory was a naturalistic theory. We have traveled much beyond naturalism. And today, in 21st century, we have to think ahead. And lastly, I would request you, if any one of you invent anything, innovate anything, do something like a young startup, do intimate me, because that will please me the most. And I am extremely happy to converse with you today. It's a Sunday morning, a pleasant morning, and you are a different kind of audience. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Would His Lordship be willing to accept a few questions that the students may have?
Questions relating to?
Relating to a few moral questions, sir.
Okay.
So as there is external justice, there is internal justice as well. So the justice that we deliver to ourselves. So how to bring justice to our personal lives is one question somebody has asked.
I must say, this question has nothing to do with law, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Let us discuss. You see, external justice means when you are involved in a litigation, justice is done in accordance with law, right? So, second part of the question is, how does one do justice to oneself, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
That's the second part of the question.
Yes, sir.
Then you have to pose yourself the question, what am I deserving? There are three beautiful sayings which I will share with the querist. First, deserve, then desire, and then you will find the mark of justness. Supposing you don't read and some other young friend of yours reads, you can't expect that you will get 90% without reading. You are thinking some kind of unjust award for yourself. That is not justice. Second, supposing I am 5 feet tall, I cannot become 6 feet tall overnight or at the age of 30. You don't know how to drive a plane, ride a plane, I mean. You cannot do it overnight. Thus, it means you must accept your limitations. First, deserve and desire. Second, accept your limitations. Third, at times you may feel jealous, but never, never feel envious. Jealousy has an immediate reason. Envy has no reason. Supposing your friend has got something good, whatever it is, you understand what jealousy means. Envy is you don't know, but you are envious. Like somebody has become a great cricketer. He's doing something great. You have nothing to do with cricket, but you are envious of him. You know what is this envy? This comes from within of a cynical mind. He's envious of eminence. Envious of eminence because he has not achieved eminence. I don't want any student, or for that matter, any human being to be in that net. In such a case, he can't do justice to himself. Justice can be done to oneself if his mind is rationally functional and if he spiritually surrenders to Almighty. I say, mark my words, spiritual surrender and rational thought, then you will get justice, apart from those three things I told. I hope that will meet the requirement of the query of the gentleman.
Indeed, sir. Thank you. I thank His Lordship for such an advanced and inspiring talk. I am sure the youth that witnessed this talk would be greatly inspired to achieve their maximum potential. Technics is deeply honored for His Lordship could take out some of his valuable time to speak for the youth. Now I would like to invite Technics 21's counselor, Professor Rajesh Kumar Upadhyay, sir, to deliver the vote of thanks.
First of all, I would like to thank Lordship Deepak Mishra, sir, for finding out his valuable time. I know that he is very busy, but still he found some of his time to give us this talk. It was very enlightening and profound. And I'm sure that whoever has attended this talk will go back with some of his thoughts, whatever he has provoked, and this will change and mold their lives further. So thank you, sir, for giving such a nice talk. And I would also like to thank the participants who has actually made it successful, and also like to thank the Technics team who worked very hard and dedicatedly so that we can have a personality like Deepak Mishra, sir, on board. And his thought-provoking talk, whatever he has given, I was completely kind of inspired the way sir has speak, and I hope everyone might have felt in the same way. So with this, I would like to thank sir once again for finding the time for us, and we can conclude the session. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.